Well, hello everyone, and welcome back to part two of my first world tour. Before we jump back into this world, though, I wanted to show you quickly some of the options that you've got on the PS4 edition that we don't have on Bedrock, for whatever reason. And that is amplified worlds. We can actually make worlds that have very large mountains and very deep valleys and caverns and stuff, and just like the text says there. And it's just such a cool way of, you know, just a nice little different option. And you can also do custom super flats as well, where you can change whatever you want, like what sort of blocks are used and all that strange stuff. So it's nice that 4J put this option in to console edition. And I'm just going to quickly load up a world and just show you what an amplified world looks like if you play on Bedrock exclusively and you've never seen one of these before. They are really cool. Shouldn't take too long to load up. But yeah, it would be very nice if one day Mojang would add this this option to Bedrock, because I would love to be able to play on an amplified world. Ever since Season 3 of Hermitcraft did one, and it just looked like so much fun because the terrain is just so extreme. And I don't think it's quite as extreme on the PS4 version as it is on Java, but it is still very, very much more mountainous and hilly than it normally would be. If we just give it a chance to load up, because you can move extremely fast in creative in this version. I don't know why that is. Much more faster than you can on Bedrock and Java, but it means that the world struggles to load. There's a lone swamp tree there up on a hill, but you see what I mean about the mountains and the hills. It's just, they are absolutely like sheer cliffs everywhere, and I just love the generation. And also you end up with lots of like shadowy areas as well, so even during the day you'll get mobs spawning underneath where all the areas where it's dark. But the worlds just look so incredibly interesting like this. Just, you know, completely different to what you're used to in Minecraft. And yeah, like I say, it would be really nice if they added this as an option at some point. And while I was looking around as well, I found this. Look at this woodland mansion that's generated with like 50 blocks tall of cobblestone, at least it's got to be. I wonder if it's solid. Is this solid? Yeah, it's not even hollow either. It is actually a solid cobblestone base. It's probably 50 blocks cubed. That's insane. But that's what happens when it tries to generate it in an amplified world and there's like extreme hills all around it. So yeah, weird. Different. But I just want to quickly talk about one of the other inspirational factors that got me started to play Minecraft, and that is my love of South Park. I love South Park. I've watched it from the very beginning all the way up to like today, you know. And there was a particular episode that they highlighted the craze of Minecraft, and in this episode called Informative Murder Porn, all the parents of South Park have started watching shows, like crime shows, that sexualize spousal homicide. And of course, you know, the children are kind of like very worried about this, and they're scared that it's going to cause like some real life issues between the parents. So they put a parental lock on the cable. And the question to unlock it is, how do you tame a horse in Minecraft? Of course, you know, the parents don't have a clue how to do this. And this is why they put that particular question on there, because no parent would have a clue how to tame a horse in Minecraft. And of course, the boys won't tell the parents what, you know, what the answer to the password is. So the parents take matters into their own hands.
Look, we were told that you were available for hire and we're desperate.
You was told wrong, mister. I'm just a simple kid with a simple passion for simple things.
We have 100 ounces of silver.
Wipe your feet and turn off your cell phones. Now, we're going to select an empty world. Selecting an empty world will begin you being dropped onto a beach. Now you're free to roam around and start punching trees.
Punching trees?
Why would we punch trees?
Just use your f***ing brain. How do you get wood? How do you get wood?
Watching informative murder porn?
Oh, no, in this Minecraft forest, how do you get wood?
Punching trees?
Right. You punch the trees to get the wood. You get the wood to build the cabin.
Oh, I see. So when does the game start?
You are playing the game. This is the game.
I don't get it.
That's because you're thinking like a dad. Minecraft, it don't got no winner. It don't got no objective. You just f***ing build it and seeing if other things can come and knock it down. Now, let's click on the inventory and let's filter through the skins.
Yes, I'm getting it now.
You are?
No.
So eventually the parents manage to work out the answer to the question and unlock the cable again. So the boys then have to go to the cable company and talk to them directly, which leads to this hilarious scene. So the boys manage to persuade the cable company to stop showing informative murder porn shows on the cable. And so the parents have no other option really other than to act out their fantasies in Minecraft instead.
Sharon? Hey Sharon, you here?
I'm here, Randy.
It's beautiful, isn't it? Come on over here. I built us a fire. Look what I got you.
Diamonds. They're beautiful.
Just thought I'd surprise you. And there's more where that came from.
I've got a surprise for you, too, Randy.
Oh, yeah? What's that? Sharon, what the effing f*** was that? Jesus, you stuck a pickaxe right in my skull! Hold on, stay by the lake. I want to kill you now.
Okay. Oh my god, you put that sword right through my face.
That felt so good.
My turn again.
Okay, hang on.
I've always thought about murdering you in your sleep. Can you go to the cabin and get in bed?
Yeah, okay, I'm heading there now.
You lazy jerk! You never do anything around the house!
Oh, you
Oh. Oh, I love you, Randy.
I love you too, babe. Oh!
So that was that episode was out in 2013, so this was a little bit before I started playing Minecraft, maybe less than a year. And it just made me wonder, you know, what is this game called Minecraft? And because they never answered the question in the episode either, how do you tame a horse in Minecraft? And I just wanted to, that was one of the reasons I wanted to find out how you tame a horse in Minecraft. So, so going back to the different options, you can actually reset your nether and your end in this version as well without having to go into like a world editor or anything like that. You can just click that option there and the next time you load up your world it will have been reset. Obviously it's not a good idea to do that to your nether very often, unless you really don't care about your nether, but I do because I've got lots of tunnels and stuff dug there. But the end, you want to do that from time to time because you're only going to get one or two tiny little cities, so to get any number of shulker boxes you're going to need to reset that end a lot and fight that dragon a lot, which is kind of annoying. But one thing I did forget to show you in the last part of the tour video, which I really should have while we're in this area, is my giant slime farm that I built down here. This was a very epic undertaking and one of those things where you really just don't need to build a farm this big, but that doesn't stop us Minecraft players from building insane farms. And you know, I worked out from chunk base, this was the first time I ever used chunk base, that there was four slime chunks in a perfect position like this. So you got two on the left and two on the right, and it was under this ocean here as well, so I didn't really have to spawn proof anything. And yeah, it's just bonkers. I kind of followed like a tutorial from like a Java farm and trapped a load of iron golems in these little areas here and built the big platforms where the slime spawn on. And I do realize now that, you know, I could increase the spawn rates even more if I changed the torches out for jack-o'-lanterns, but I really just do not need to. I really don't need any more slime from this farm. It's just crazy the amount of slime it actually produces. Just while I was building this farm, I've got like several double chests of slime blocks, and you see how effective it is. The slimes try to get to the iron golems and they die on the magma blocks, and then the minecart with hopper underneath that's running around just picks all the slime balls off and then deposits them down the other end. So it works very efficiently. Don't need an auto clicker or, you know, looting three or anything like that. And it's exactly the same on the other side. They just flop down, they see the iron golems eventually, and then they try to get to them and they just die on the magma blocks because they're dumb. So yeah, I think there's 12 iron golems in this farm in total, 3 on each bit. And then, yeah, this is the collection system. So it's very low down in the world, this was. I tried to build it as low as possible to get as many spawning platforms in as possible. And yeah, I mean, this is just a small amount that's just built up over the last, you know, times that I've been looking around the farm, really. I've emptied it out so many times. I've only AFK'd this thing once ever for a few hours. That's how bad it is, like, or how good it is. It just produces so much slime, and I don't have a use for it. Like, there's at least a couple of double chests of the stuff back at my base, just doing nothing. I'm never going to need it. But it was a fun project, digging out 6 entire chunks from top to bottom underneath an ocean. It was the first time I've ever done anything like this, so... Here's a world map. Well, it's not really a world map. It's a map of my sort of local area around where my villages are. This is up in the north village of Carrot, near where my storage base is. And there's the southern village of Potato. And when I eventually got a bit more serious with this game and worked out that mending was a thing, or is a thing, and I wanted it, so I eventually managed to get it, and in order to use it to repair your items, you need experience. And this was the best way that I could find to begin with to get some easy XP. So I found a skeleton spawner, because I think skeletons give you the most XP. And then you just basically just stand here for a little while, let them build up. It doesn't take too long. It's not like mega slow, but it's not mega fast either. And then when you're ready, you flick that lever there, and it suffocates them using this redstone here. I followed a tutorial from Izuma, like one of his first tutorials, where he sounds unrecognisable almost. It suffocates them to the point where they are a one-hit kill, and you can kill them with anything. So the item that you want to mend, that's got mending in your hand, you just hit them with it, and... away you go, yeah. Or you could, you know, take off your armor and as well, and that would make it even better. Because this game, you know, it doesn't... It just randomly puts the XP onto whatever needs it, basically. So if you stripped off and just had your pick in your hand, then yeah, it would just repair the pick. But this is incredibly slow. Incredibly slow. It could take me 20 minutes just to fix one pickaxe. So I decided that I would try to make something a little bit faster than that. And where I'd been experimenting with villagers for the first time and breeding them and doing some stuff like that, I decided to build a faster XP farm. And also, I just wanted to quickly highlight here, like while I'm running down these tunnels, check out how much my hunger is going down. Like you lose hunger in this game just from sprinting in this version. And... that's kind of crazy. Like, look, I'm nearly down to, like, starvation level just from running from one nether tunnel part to another. It's bonkers. But to counteract that, you do regenerate health a lot quicker in this version of the game than you do in Bedrock. So, but still, you shouldn't be losing hunger just from sprinting, only jumping. Or should you? I don't know which version is right. You know, you tell me. But this place down here is my sort of industrial area that I'd started to develop when I got a little bit more serious into the game. It's down in the southwest of the world, and I came across this village and thought, right, this is going to be the place then. This is going to be where I'm going to set some farms up and stuff. This here is my first ever farm that I built following a tutorial for a sugarcane farm from... You could probably guess who? The gateway drug into Hermitcraft, the person that you find on the internet, and then follow a tutorial, then you can't stop watching them. Yes, it's Mumbo Jumbo, of course. So you know, I found this tutorial, didn't understand how any of it worked really, because I didn't know how to do any redstone, but I just followed his easy to use tutorial. And it worked. It was amazing. And I just built 2 sections of it. You could build it as high as you wanted, really. But Two was enough for me. I needed lots and lots of sugarcane to trade with librarians to get my mending books, because I didn't really have any other good way of getting emeralds that I knew of at the time. And as you can see, it produces a reasonable amount of sugarcane over time. It's just a passive farm, it's nothing fancy. And also in here we have my AFK fish farm. Again, this was a tutorial that I found from Azuma, and it works perfectly in this version of the game. And now I need to remember where my fishing rod is. Right, I found my fishing rod. And there is a sweet spot you've got to get with this farm. It's just about there. So the aim is to try and get the bobber to stay in this water source here, and then you'll eventually catch some fish. Or, you know, you might get something nice as well, like a book or an enchanted bow or something like that. So yeah, this was a really handy farm. I AFK'd it overnight a few times, and yeah, it's done me well, and I've mostly left the junk in there at the moment. But yeah, you get some books. They're the rubbish books, and you get a lot of other rubbish as well, but there'd be, you know, one or two nice things in there from time to time. And directly below that, so it should be loaded all the time while I'm in this industrial area, is a farm that I built that never really worked out that great, to be honest. It's supposed to be a creeper farm. I needed gunpowder. This was before I built the witch farm. And there's a lot of redstone going on down here as well. There's a lot of clocks and stuff, opening up dispensers to dispense water every now and then to sort of flush creepers out of the system. And yeah, like I say, it just never really worked great, because in this version of the game, you know, you want to build a farm as low down in the world as possible, because the spawning starts down at the bottom. At least, you know, it does in Java, and I'm pretty sure that's the same in this version of the game. So you got all of these little different chambers down here, and only creepers can spawn in them, or bats, apparently. And then every now and then they'll get flushed out by the water, like the clock will get to that point, and it will open the dispensers and flush them out, and then close them back up again by picking up the water. There we go. And the water flows down and then washes the creepers out, and then they die on the magma blocks in the middle there. But I don't know, it just doesn't seem to ever produce that many. Like, it was very, very slow. It always has been. I tried to light up as many caves in the area as possible, but nothing seemed to really work to get, like, to really focus the spawns in this farm. And as you can see from the collection, you know, it's barely got a stack and a half, and that's, you know, it should always be loaded in this sort of area underneath my industrial area. But yeah, there's this lovely giant ravine running through here as well, and that could do with a bit better lighting. But yeah, there's a creeper that's just spotted me. Wow, he is on a mission to get to me. Let's just take him out quickly. Die. Whoa, what? Jesus. Well, with nearly full armor with protection 4, he managed to pop my totem. I honestly swear, like, this version is slightly harder, like, than Bedrock. Like, the creepers, you know, they shouldn't do that much damage. Well, they don't on, they certainly don't on Bedrock. But so this is the remains of my villager breeder. This was back in the days before village and pillage made it bed-based breeding. This used to be a giant cobblestone box surrounded by doors. Doors on all sides. There was about 50 odd doors all the way around it. And then just carrots in the middle here, which a lot of them have been trampled and just replaced by grass now over the time. And the villagers would just spend all their time in here breeding, throwing carrots at each other. And I eventually managed to find a librarian that had mending. And, you know, I locked him in, because it was completely random back then. You know, there was no, like, put down the workstation, pick it back up again. Oh, and this is the drop chute, by the way. So when you got one that you didn't want, you just nudged them down there and bye-bye. Like nitwits and librarians that didn't have a good trade or something like that. So yeah, there was no workstations. It was just completely random. So it took so much time to get a mending villager. And yeah, when I did, and you can only buy two books a day before they lock out. Right, so I just want to quickly show you my gold/XP farm, which is basically 12 giant max size nether portals. And let's just land in the middle here. So basically piglins, zombie pigmen, should I say. It's not zombie piglins, it's zombie pigmen. Because in this version of the game, there was no nether update. There never has been, and then there never will be. So they're always going to be zombie pigmen. So you've got some snow golems in the middle here, and they throw snowballs at any pigmen, that generate from the portals and aggro them, and they try to get to the snow golems, and then they just end up falling off, and then they're at the mercy of the water streams. And then you see like they're all sort of gathering here on this block there. So I would go down here and close that door after me, because the number of times I've had things get in here after me. Now, I will apologise, this is very, very noisy. Right, so you let them build up, and then you flick the lever again, and then it will start block suffocating them like it did with the skeleton grinder. So yeah, this is the rate at which they generate in. It's not particularly fast, but it's a steady trickle, you know, and it gives you a lot more XP than the skeletons do as well. And with the added bonus that you get the occasional bit of gold as well. And you could just sit here and use it as a gold farm if you wanted just gold. You can sit here and just, you know, slap them up with your looting three sword. And yeah, this is going to suffocate them for about 6 seconds, I think that was. And then they're a one-shot kill. And then you just sit there and hit them. Obviously the babies don't get suffocated, so you'll have to just kill them with your sword like normal. Sorry, baby pigman. And that's all there is to it, really. I mean, all the XP there, I think, probably went on my boots, but maybe a little bit went on my pick as well, I think. So, and then by the time you finish dealing with them, another load is built up, and then you just rinse and repeat. So you just suffocate. Also in this game there is entity cramming as well, so you can't just let them build up to the point where like there's hundreds of them, because they start suffocating and taking damage when there's 24 or more in there, so you can't do that either. But as you can see, yeah, they're all one shot kills, and I am getting some of the XP added to my actual XP bar as well. But as you can see, it is fixing my pickaxe. And it's so much quicker than the skeleton one. And like I say, with the added bonus, you get some drops as well. So I can smelt swords up and sell the rotten flesh to some clerics, which is an option, I guess. But yeah, it's not a bad alternative, but it's nowhere near as good as the gold XP farms on Bedrock, because you need like so many giant portals that are constantly lit in this version, which can be a bit laggy. I think if I added any more than the 12, then I would cause some serious lag in this area. Right, next thing is the kelp farm. This was inspired by the aquatic update, which was 1.13. When we got this, eventually, because Java got it about 4 or 5 months before we did on PlayStation Edition, which was a bit annoying, having to wait that long for it. It was like nearly half a year. And watching the guys on Season 6 of Hermitcraft having so much fun with all the new features. And I've dropped my pickaxe again. I keep doing that. I keep pressing circle instead of crouch. So this is the return station for the flying machine. So it's basically, yeah, it's just based on some underwater flying machines. And the kelp, I dug all of this lake out. This lake was only a few blocks deep, so I dug all of this out by hand. And this is the actual flying machine itself. So I place a repeater here, because you can place redstone underwater in this version. And then I think we just have to flick that trapdoor there to set it off. Trigger the observer like so, and off it goes. Now PlayStation 4 version is hopeless when it comes to like loads of entities like this. It just cannot cope. So as you'll see, like, they're all just disappearing because it can't cope with this many just things in the world. Like, all of that kelp is just wasted, completely wasted. But it can deal with some. So that stuff at the end there will stay there. And then over time, the idea is you just leave this machine running. So basically it just goes back and forth, skims off one or two bits of kelp that have grown in between cycles. And then there's a top flying machine that will knock it all into water streams that I've ran. And this was inspired by a Zoomer Void from his farm that he built on Hermitcraft Season 6. I really enjoy watching Azuma's videos. He's like probably my favourite hermit, and you know, I just like his style. That he, you know, he's the way he talks, the, you know, the things that he likes to do. It's very, very similar to the way I like to play the game. You know, not too seriously, but you know, he gets sort of reasonably technical, and you know, he's kind of the person that runs the place as well. So he's got a lot of sort of behind the scenes things to worry about. So I've got to try and set off this top fly machine at the perfect time in conjunction with the bottom fly machine. So they've both got to be almost perfectly sort of in unison. The top one needs to be about a second behind the bottom one. So if I set it off now, it should ping kelp just at the right time. Let's have a look. Ignore that one there though, it's probably already there. So, and all this stuff was already here as well. So this will act a bit differently because it's been allowed to like sort of float to the surface. It will probably just sink now. But when it's when it's broken for the first time and it's rising up, that top one will ping it before it reaches the surface. Just ping it. And it throws it miles over into the water streams that I've rend, and then it just funnels down into the pumping station. But I think at this point that top one is a little bit too close to the bottom one, so I'd have to delay it again. And then yeah, this water stream where it all ends up. And I got a lot of kelp from this. I mean, you remember seeing in my storage in the last video, I got double chests of kelp blocks. And again, I'm never going to use it for any amount of smelting or building or anything like that, but it was a fun project to do. You know, like sometimes you just build these wild and wacky projects in Minecraft just to say you've done it, you know, just for the lols. So I think that is about the perfect spacing now for these two, so it should just carry on just pinging the kelp one way or the other. Except that one there, that hit the side. And it should end up in the water stream, like so. And then it'll all flow into the pumping station, which I'll jump around and show you in a moment. Right, so this is the building here where all of the kelp is going to end up. There's like two water streams in there, in the sort of behind the lake. And yeah, there's a lot of smokers in here. And why has it not started smelting yet? Don't know. I'll check that in a second. But so that there's a water stream that links from one side, is like the one closest to us, and then the far one on this side here is the further water stream. And I can hear odd little bits splashing in the kelp. There it comes. It's just designed to produce a steady trickle of the stuff. And oh, that would be why it's not smelting. There's a slime block in there for some reason. I don't know why that's got in there. This one's now smelting as well. But over time, these will all catch up with each other, and every single one of these eight smokers will actually be full and smelting away constantly, to the point where there's even so much kelp coming in that there's overflow chests on the end as well, and that will end up just building up as well. And then If I left it like really long time while I'm working in this area, it would start to just build up on top of the hoppers up there, where it just cannot go anywhere else. So yeah, this obviously is self-fueling as well, so I can craft it all up into dried kelp blocks and then just refill all these here, so it's got a constant fuel source as well. But yeah, like I say, this was just, I saw a Zuma Void doing it and I was inspired. I just wanted to do something like this for myself and see, and just see if it was possible on this version of the game. And of course, you know, I had to really, you know, look for my kelp, because this was an old existing world, so I had to go like somewhere completely well out of the way to find some new generated chunks in the top part of the world to find some kelp. But all I needed was a handful, and I managed to find it quite easily. And yeah, as you can see, they're starting to fill up now, the smokers. We've got four going now. It won't be long before, you know, it starts to fill up even more, and kelp is just trickling in almost sort of constantly now, and it will quickly start to fill up those hoppers and those smokers, and then it will start eventually ending up in the overflow kelp at the end there. So yeah, it works brilliantly, but it got to the point where it was just producing so much that I turned it off, because no one needs that much kelp. So, but yeah, we're just going to quickly take a flight up here, and I thought I'd show you what was my perfectly fine working iron farm. So back before village and pillage, also, yeah, I had to put glowstone around this thing, because it kept freezing the water sources because we're in a mountain area. So back before village and pillage, this was a perfectly functioning iron farm, and as you can see now, it is not. I needed loads more villagers to make it work, and loads more workstations, which I never needed before, and now the golems generate in there when they're supposed to generate in the middle, and it's just never really worked that well since. It still produces some, but nowhere near what it used to produce back before village and pillage. So as you can see, yeah, there is a lot of villagers in here, and yes, I do realize there's a few nitwits and they don't contribute anything, so I might as well get rid of them. But I don't, when I played this version of the game, I didn't really know that much about villagers or the game mechanics in general. I just had a sort of rough idea of what to go off based off what I'd seen, you know, on Hermitcraft and stuff like that. So, but like I say, this farm worked pretty well before that last update. And yes, it produces lots of cats now as well, which it never used to do as well. And of course, the cats share the mob cap with the golems as well. So if there's loads of cats running around, you're not going to get many golems either. So as you can see, yeah, it produces some iron, but nowhere near enough, like, for a farm this size, which was a shame. But yeah, this was like one of the first sort of weird, wacky farms I built way up in the sky. And believe it or not, it was usually loaded while I was in this area, and over time it would produce a fair amount of iron. But those days are long gone now, sadly. Yeah, iron farms just never really worked properly on this version of the game after village and pillage, which was 1.14. And over here we've got my creeper farm, which, again, it never really worked that great to begin with, to be honest. So imagine the roof used to be covered in nothing but trapdoors. I've taken them off to repurpose them elsewhere, because I didn't really have a tree farm in this world, so wood was quite precious to me, and I needed all the trapdoors for that other creeper farm down below. So I stripped them all out. But basically, there would be a cat in the middle there on that carpet, and the creepers would spawn in, see the cat, and run into like one of the areas to the side there, and then fall down into a water stream. And then the water stream would eventually wash them down to this central tube here, and they would fall to their doom onto the hoppers here. But it never really produced that many that quickly. Like, I'd get like maybe a stack of gunpowder from a few hours of AFK, which is pathetic. And over time I just realized that it just wasn't worth it. And then they changed the mechanics so that cats don't even scare creepers anymore. So, you know, good luck getting an ocelot to stay up there. It's a nightmare. So yeah, I quickly realized that it was just much easier to use a witch farm for gunpowder. That produces more than enough gunpowder for my needs, so that's what I did. Right, last stop on the tour of my first world is the Raid Tower. So remember I said when we got Village and Pillage, I'd left some parts of the world unexplored in the top west. And this is where I found my one and only raid tower in the entire world. So we'll just hop through. Oh, I forgot, yeah, there's actually a raid already in progress here as well, because it's just constant. It's just a constant barrage of pillagers in this area. I don't know why, they just generate like crazy around this thing at night time. And it doesn't take long before you get bad omen again, and I've got a villager set up down there. So that, and also the there might have been a little bit of an accident with the raid tower involving some lava. And they're mostly wood, aren't they, up the top, and so a lot of it burnt down, unfortunately. But, you know, that doesn't stop the pillagers spawning around this area. They don't spawn in the tower in this version of the game. They spawn like around it. So when it gets to nighttime, they spawn like crazy. And it doesn't take long before you get a banner dude and then you know, kill him. And away you go. But in this version also, you don't get vindicators in the random patrols. They only appear in the raids themselves. So I just want to quickly show you just how crazy raids are in this version of the game, because they seem to be a lot worse than on Bedrock. Like, you get way more mobs, which is much more sort of similar to the Java version, and they seem faster, which is much more closer to the Java version as well. And of course it's like, where are they? Oh, there they are. They've generated over there. They seem to generate from a long way away. You know, with the power of foresight and hindsight, I would have built it so that there was a giant spawning platform up in the sky. You know, I just didn't realise that at the time. I was just trying to just experiment by myself, you know. I think this was before many people had actually made any sort of large-scale raid farms, and certainly not on this version of the game. And also, yeah, the witches look a little bit weird and different on this version. They've got, like, purple stuff over their ears. Here we go, here's a Vindicator. This is why you want a bow. Bows are really good for raids in this version, because like I say, they're so quick. You want to try and keep them as sort of arm's length as long as possible, especially those annoying pillagers with the crossbows. They are so annoying. And that's where they take... And the Ravagers are much quicker as well. Oh no, not the Vexes. No. Vexes are a nightmare in this version, because again, they don't die... so easily. They're more than a one-hit kill, unlike in Bedrock. And also the pillagers themselves, even with sharpness 5, they all take 3 hits to kill with my sword, which is not the case on Bedrock. Like, they die to like 2 hits, I think, with sharpness 3, sharpness 5 even. So I'm going to take this guy out at range, and I've got to get used to the bow again on this version of the game. You have to aim it up a little bit. But already, just from one evoker, look at how many Vexes there are flying around. They do summon a lot of them, and very quickly. But yeah, you see, like, the Ravager. You know, the Ravager seems so much quicker in this version of the game. I don't know if its head looked bigger as well, but I can't remember. It's been a while since I've faced a Ravager in the open world. The Vexes, they're so annoying. Oh, and there's like, now we've got the next wave loaded in as well. See how many there are, and this isn't even the final wave yet. There's so many Vindicators, look how many there are. But yeah, your health regenerates quicker in this version, but your food, your hunger goes down so quickly from swinging your sword and running around. So you're constantly having to eat, which is kind of a bit annoying. They're all going to plop down there, which is fine. I'm happy with that. But oh no, there's a witch down here, and she's poisoned me. Great. And now I've got Vexes to deal with as well. Oh, and I've popped my totem. Great. Whoops. What are we going to do here? I'm going to have to like dig my way out of this in a second, I think. Yeah. I don't want to go near that guy yet. So, also, you get evokers on the Ravagers, but you do that. You do get those in Bedrock as well. But, like I say, everything just seems to take more hits to kill in this version of the game. And now it's getting nighttime as well, and there's Vexes everywhere. this is really bad news because there's about to be a ton of pillagers spawning that aren't even part of this raid around this area. And yeah, this could end very badly because I haven't got a totem now. I need a totem. Where's a totem? Look how many vexes there are. Oh, there's a totem. Let's just quickly get that. Juggle it into my hotbar. Right. Just about managed to do that in the nick of time before I died again. Which isn't advisable. But yeah, these now there's some random pillagers that are just generating in from this area because they just seem to generate naturally around raid towers in the darkness. So you can easily build a farm now, knowing how things work in this version of the game. I think I could do a much better version next time, like build it up in the sky, make a dark spawning platform where like the pillagers could spawn in to get the bad omen, and then like a platform up higher, even higher up, where the actual raids generate in, and then sort of wash down into a central area or something. Yeah, might be fun to try and revisit this version at some point and try and work out a better farm for it. But yeah, now I'm getting bad omen all over again. So next, when I finish this raid, straight away we're gonna get another raid start probably from the villager in the middle there. Hence why I say it's just constant. But I need to skip the night quickly because I can't keep this up. There's just too many of them. And look at how many vexes there are. I think we're on the final wave. Oh no, I've just lost another totem. So like, you get a few totems from each raid. You probably get about 4 or 5. But I'm a bit rusty, okay? I've lost about 3 on this raid alone. But if you're good, then you can do all you can get about 5 without losing any. But the key is you've got to take out those evokers before they start summoning in all the vexes, because now it becomes like unmanageable. There's so many of them now, and they just keep doing it. These guys are generating in because, you know, it's dark. And they just get everywhere. They just get absolutely everywhere. Now there's vexes everywhere as well. So this is it's not looking good. And like I say, I've lost my totem again. So I really need to pick that totem up that other evoker's just dropped there. But you see what I mean though? It is much harder on this version of the game than it is on Bedrock. Much, much harder. It's I wouldn't say it's as hard as Java, but it's definitely harder than it is on Bedrock. Definitely harder. I think I'm just gonna like bug out of here and retreat into the tower in the middle there. By jumping over here, they can't actually follow me. So that was that. There's one mob remaining, and it's fallen down the middle here, and it's a ravager. So the idea with this farm was that I could just stand down here, and they would all generate in, and then they would fall down the middle there, trying to get to the villager. And yes, I've just got a bad omen again. So I'll just take out this ravager. And that is the end of that raid. Where'd you keep coming from? Jeez. But yeah, it's a good way to get loads and loads of emeralds and totems, and it's just a lot more sort of hard work than it is with like an automatic farm, you know. But it still does the job, you know. Gets me all the things I want out of it. So it's nice to be able to play around with this new mechanic. It was one of the last things that, you know, was kind of added to this version of the game, the village and pillage update. And as you can see, yeah, it's a little bit backed up, but that's just from the sheer amount of just junk that this farm produces as well. All the armor and broken tools and crossbows and stuff. And here comes the next raid. We're not even going to hang around. I have had enough of raids around this area here. So we're just going to quickly go back to the portal and get the hell out of here, because I can't be dealing with that all over again. So anyway, that does conclude the tour of my very first world. I hope you have all enjoyed it. It's been a lot of fun to sort of revisit this area. It brings back a lot of lot of happy memories. I spent years and years in this world, pretty much all on my own, just learning how to play Minecraft. You know, first of all, not having an absolute clue, but just finding my own way, and then eventually sort of learning extra things from the internet and from other people on sort of Hermitcraft and other Java players. And yeah, it was just, I love it. You know, I just love Minecraft, and this is part of the reason why I love it as much as I do, because this world, you know, was just so much fun. It was just, I could just jump on whenever I felt like it and just do, you know, do me for, you know, for a day at a time or so. And yeah, I just love it. So I hope you've enjoyed it. Please, you know, consider subscribing if you're not already, because you know I do make other videos, believe it or not. And I've dropped my sword again. And I will see you for another video very soon. Take care, guys, and bye for now.